Welcome to this QBS talk. This is a specific talk for all the people who are interested in CRM products and pricing, and especially about around all the licensing involved. This webinar will be recorded, so it will be available on the QBS website after this talk anyway. So please attend your colleagues or peers if you want to. It will be available for review afterwards. So what we are going to talk about is Microsoft Dynamics 365 licensing and pricing, and I will be focusing especially on licensing and pricing around the customer engagement part of Dynamics 365. So first of all, in a very brief introduction of myself, it will be on the last slide as well in this presentation. I don't want to take a lot of time in introducing myself, but my name is Arjen Janssen. I have been in the CRM business for around 25 years or so, something around that. And especially the last 18 years, specific on Microsoft products and CRM. So I have been with the development of Dynamics 365 customer engagement, which was formerly known as Dynamics CRM or Microsoft CRM, since the beginning. So I've seen all versions and all growth and all growing pains. But what was particularly interesting is how mature all these products have become. And you will see that reflected in licensing as well. It came into being as being one product, especially tailored around customer relationship management. And it's now much more than that. So that's why it's also called customer engagement. And on customer engagement, there's a lot more to tell. So new products as well, especially since the introduction this spring, we have been waiting, well, especially the CRM people have been waiting for this for some time. So we are very, very keen on getting this into our customer base as fast as we can. So we can't wait for Microsoft to release all ordering capabilities of all SKUs, but most of them are available as we speak and in most regions as well. So that will be interesting to see how fast that will grow. I have to press for the next slide, of course. So let's see, this is the total overview of all products in the Dynamics 365 product family. And you, as you can see, it's a lot more than only CRM or operations. There's a ton of products to be sold. And what we can, deduct from this graph is that probably not all products can be in your specialty. So you have to focus, you have to specialize. And I would advise not to specialize in all products at once, because, well, it would be hurting your credibility anyway. And the other one is that those products are for total different markets as well. So they're tailored for different types of customers and different markets anyway. So we probably all know Business Central, the right top box called Business Central, formerly known as NAV. NAV is still around, but Business Central is the online CSP version of that. Next version, and Business Central is, well, not particularly in the scope of this webinar, but Business Central, you can see as the SMB and mid-market solution for finance and operations, but a little bit different than production or retail or etc. So Business Central, only available in CSP. It's part of the Dynamics 365 family, so that's why it's shown here. It looks a bit on itself in this graph. It's highlighted because it's a new addition to the family in this capacity, to be honest. It's only looks a little bit lonely in this graph, but that's only because it's not part of any of those plans. It wouldn't make sense anyway to have it being part of those plans anyway. So then we have especially a split in the middle. We have Unified Operations. You can order that as a plan. It consists of the following products: retail, talent, finance operations, and of course Power Apps. Those are all products evolved from what was formerly known as AX, what was formerly known as Xapta. So those products are not in the scope of this session today and are mostly tailored for enterprise businesses anyway. So, but so you know, it's part of the family, so that's why it's in here. And at the left side of the middle, we have all Dynamics 365 customer engagement products. And those are originated formerly from the CRM product. So if we look at the product that was formerly known as Dynamics CRM, two specific products evolved from that. One is customer engagement for sales, and the other one is customer engagement for customer service, or otherwise known as Dynamics 365 for sales and Dynamics 365 for customer service. Those two products originate directly from the formerly known CRM product. And the other two products, the two boxes under that, are field service and project automation. Both are new additions to the family, fairly new. They are, have been around for 2 years, 2.5 years now. So, well, I think I have to stop saying that they are new, but they are fairly new to the family. Field Service is a part of a board company called Field One. That product has been redesigned by Microsoft to add more value to it and to integrate more with CRM. It already was built as an ISV solution to CRM. And Project Service Automation is built from scratch and is tailored specifically to handle project organizations doing project stuff, getting deadlines, etc. And field services more tailored for managing machinery, connected with IoT, and all those, all that stuff. So all on the same technology base, what was formerly known as CRM. A new addition to that customer engagement family is marketing. There has, that it needs a little bit of more of an explanation. There has been a marketing product been around for some time, Microsoft Dynamics Marketing, formerly known as that. That product has been retired, I would say 2 years ago, so like 2 years ago. Microsoft retired the product and advised all customers to go to Adobe Marketing Suite. Well, that's a good choice. It's still a enterprise solution, so probably not for every customer. So most organizations, and probably that is well known amongst CRM partners, chose for a solution called Click Dimensions, which is effectively an ISV who has built a mass marketing and lead scoring and nurturing and campaign solution around Dynamics CRM. So that solution has been around for some time, still a very solid solution, to be honest, and would still be a good alternative at the lower end of the spectrum. So I would still say give that a proper look. I am not advertising Microsoft here, so I am an independent one, so I can advise you on that. So Click Dimension has been around for some time now. It's also being heavily used by the people of QBS as well, as I know. So a solid solution, very good. So nothing wrong with that. But what is really nice is the new marketing product from Microsoft. It has been just released April 1st this year, and that's not a joke, to be honest. So no April Fools here, and marketing is a entirely new product. What you see here is a few details on it: 2K context, 10K context. So what are they? Effectively, what marketing, all products in this Dynamics 365 overview are licensed on a per user per month basis, except for marketing, which is effectively only licensed per organization. And the number of contacts you involve in campaigns effectively are counted. So they account for specific licensing licensing versions. So that's how that works. Then there is a special license version called Team Members. We will come back to that a little bit more later on in our slide deck. Team members can be seen as lightweight users, and specifically in the Unified Operations Plan, you have devices and activities user licenses. They are not of real relevance to our session today, but they are specifically tailored, for example, in retail. There could be a device license for a POS system, point of sale system. So, and that's how that really works. So that's more specific for those markets and those products. So we will be talking about the customer engagement plan side, where we have sales, customer service, field service, project service automation, the new marketing product, and Power Apps. We'll linger a little bit on Power Apps, and we have a team member lightweight user for that as well. So going forward, the slide. So those are the apps we are talking about. I lifted them out of this. Customer service, field service, sales, project service automation. There is a combined solution from LinkedIn Sales Navigator and Dynamics 365 for Sales called Relationship Sales Solution. Unfortunately, only enterprise, so EA customers, are able to buy this solution. It will, at some point in time, be and get available for the mid-market too. So just keep an eye on that. But up until this moment, it's not available anyway. So if you would like to combine both products, like LinkedIn Sales Navigator and Dynamics 365 for Sales, you can purchase them or resell them separately. And that effectively leads to the same relationship sales solution anyway. So it's no drama anyway, but you still have that same functionality. There is a specific version available of the Dynamics 365 for Sales solution called the Sales Professional SKU. That's a derivative of the sales solution specifically tailored for SMB customers, which has more limited capabilities. It's also at a lower price point. So it's an interesting solution to sell. There are some things to consider, though. So let's just get into that right away. So first, stop at Dynamics 365 for Sales, right? So if you go to Dynamics 365 for Sales, so only that icon from the previous slide, you go to those are the specific versions you can resell. So those are all in dollar prices. Those are the suggested retail prices, as you call it, the end customer prices. So these are the prices. Well, if you convert it to your own currency, you probably would use as well. So first of all, relationship sales. We talked about this a little, right? That's the combination of LinkedIn Sales Navigator and Dynamics 365 for Sales. So effectively, that is only available if you are a enterprise, so EA reseller. So you can resell that solution, but only if you are a enterprise EA license reseller. So in all other cases, you would have the upper limit of reselling the sales enterprise license, which is priced at a price point of $95 per user per month at an app level, and a sales professional license priced at a $65 per user per month priced. So it's a special SKU, and it entails core sales functionality. Could be a good starting point for most organizations, to be honest. So it's still a good product, but you have to take into account a few limitations here. And the last one will be the team members, which is effectively a lightweight user. And we will stipulate a little bit more what you can do and cannot do with a team member. And to most people's surprise, what I always do when I advise a Dynamics 365 for Sales solution set a license combination, I always give the managing team of my customer team member licensing, because they don't need to change any sales records. They only need to review reports, dashboards, and they can still do a little bit into CRM anyway. So in most cases, that actually works. So that's what the SQ lineup is concerned. Let me just go back a few slides. So what you also saw here is that there's a big bar on top of it. It's called Customer Engagement Plan. That license type is also available. What you effectively do here is if you sell not alone the Dynamics 365 for Sales app or customer service app or field service application, but you sell the entire plan, that's effectively giving the rights to all applications in that plan. So sales, customer service, field service, project service automation, and Power Apps and marketing for 2K contacts will be included if you sell 10 seats at a minimum. So it's pretty interesting, actually. So if you would see a need for a little bit more than sales at your customer side, probably selling a plan, even for only a few users, makes all the difference. And that's just a matter of smart licensing combinations, right? So if you go into that, ask our partner care for a little bit of advice before you send your quote out, because just a little bit more intelligent quoting of license combinations just makes deal, right? So just get back to your QBS representative anyway if you have questions around that. So coming back to Dynamics 365 for Sales SQ lineup, so let me just go a little bit further. So if you go, you see this also in the offering terms at the bottom. If you go into the difference between the Sales Enterprise and Sales Professional SKU, let me just tell you a little bit more about that. So first of all, there's all kind of a difference. The Sales Professional SKU, if you sell that at your customer, it's really okay. So it's still having, it's a little bit more limited, but your entitlement effectively gives you a little bit less than the Sales Enterprise license. For example, if you sell the Dynamics 365 for Sales Enterprise licensing version, you get not only a production instance, but also a sandbox called a non-production instance. So you can test out all your process implementation before you go live without affecting the live implementation. So that's really a benefit for a little bit larger or a little bit more formal organizations. So I would always advise if your organization has, your customer organization has a need for that, go for that route. So what you also get is a portal. Actually, that's a lot of bang for your buck, to be honest, because that portal license, you have to sell a 5-seat minimum. But if you sell that, they get a portal license as well. And when you enable that portal license, you effectively are able to open your organization data to the external world in some form or another, and you're totally in control of that. So it's really interesting. The other thing you don't get when you sell a sales professional license is dual use rights. In most cases, that's probably not really relevant anymore, but there's still cases around. And what I can tell about that is dual use rights effectively gives you the license to not only use the online version of Dynamics 365 for Sales, but you're also entitled to install a on-premise version of that same license. So it's back-to-back. For every online license, you also get a on-premise license for the same user. Just so you know, it is a named user experience. So you can, for that same user, also install a on-premise version as well. So your customer gets a choice. Well, what would in most cases be the best choice? Yeah, obviously I would advise to always go for online if you can, but in some cases your customer has a company policy or regulations to abide to and can only install an on-premise version. Still, you have the right to do that with the Sales Enterprise license. So there's nothing to worry here. Migration still can be a little bit more challenging if you go into online later, in a later stage, but still you have this and you still can stay on board with your customer anyway. So, and the last one is you have the opportunity to license devices with the enterprise license. Well, it's not really a common scenario, to be honest, in sales, but you can license devices, especially when the same device is used by a lot of users. It still can make the difference. There's not a lot of scenarios around where this is really a feasible thing, but well, it's more a production thing or more a retail thing, to be honest. But still, there is a few scenarios you can think on. And so going to the right column, in the entitlement column of Sales Professional, you only get a production instance and it's only available for named users. But in most cases, to be honest, in most cases, if you get a real look at it, that's sufficient to start with, right? So if you have a smaller sales team at a, well, let's say with simple processes, it's still a good scenario to resell the Sales Professional license. It's cheaper and, well, it's a little bit challenge to migrate upward, but you can migrate upward, and there's also migration scenarios with licensing as well. So you have licenses to migrate upward. It's really easy to do. It's technically a little bit more challenging, but still, if you do not do a lot of customizations, which you, in effect, you're not able to do a lot anyway in a Sales Professional, you're quite safe, and you can, at a later stage, if you foresee that at your customer, migrate upwards anyway. Now, the other thing is mixing both licensing types. Just don't do it. It will be, there is some scenario where you could do that, but I would say my advice would be, and that's just offering an opinion, just do not do it. Just don't combine those licenses within the same organization. So you get the slide deck anyway, it will be available anyway, but just to have a look at all the features. There's also a lot of difference in the feature capabilities. The Sales Professional will obviously be a little bit more limited, so especially on the area of customizations. So in case management, customization application module, you can do a lot more with the enterprise user, because you're effectively unlimited there. So you can build your entire vertical, convert to the entire way of how the customer works, and you're just really limited on the Sales Professional side. But probably in most cases, you wouldn't want to do any customization, only lightweight things, just a field here and a field there, and a little bit more with views and queries and subsets, maybe a dashboard or two. So that would just still suffice for smaller sales teams, small organizations. So I'm offering you both opinions here. You can still choose to go for Sales Professional, and then you win from Salesforce always. So good scenario anyway. So here is the slide about mixing and matching. There is the challenge. Because what effectively happens is, when you sell Sales Professional and when you sell enterprise licenses, you cannot combine both, because effectively what you do is you are effectively using two databases, one database for Sales Enterprise, one database for Sales Professional. So the data is not moved around, and there you get the challenge. This is not really a scenario a proper customer wants or should want. So I would say stay away from advising this. There are a few scenarios where you can do this. Let's say if you have a mother company with a bigger sales team, and you have local branches with specific subsets of customers, this would make sense. But then it also would make sense to migrate data back and forth between the enterprise instance and the production instance anyway. So you would do a lot of customizations around this, a lot of building extra data transport anyway. But that's a scenario I can kind of think of. Otherwise, I just would not take this route anyway. So the Sales Enterprise user is allowed to log into the instance of the Sales Professional user database, and not the other way around. So, okay, mother-daughter hierarchy in the organization, in large corporates, maybe a scenario. But so this is also the challenge on combining both. So if you can stay away from this, it really makes people's lives more simple. Just do not do it. So here's a little bit more around that. So if you want, there's a few scenarios here. You want to have the Sales Enterprise and Sales Professional combination, so you would have effectively two instances. You could also combine Customer Engagement Plan and Sales Professional licenses, so you have that all those products, right? Customer Service, Sales, project service automation and field service to your proposal, and the sales professional users will only have a sales professional instance. Maybe makes sense if those plan users would log into the sales professional instance also and not have their own instance for a sales enterprise. That would probably make sense, but you still have data at more places in your organization. And the last one will be combining the whole thing with team members. Well, I would say that's just overcomplicating the entire thing. So if you would do a smart combination, you probably would end up combining sales enterprise plus team members, or customer engagement plan plus team members would be the better choice, maybe. But that really depends on how you would want to advise it to your customer and how the customer needs would look like. If they don't need a complex sales or a sales with a lot of features application, maybe still that sales professional makes sense. So there's another slide. To complicate matters a little bit more, we also have a Dynamics 365 offer for SMB. Officially, that offer was ended. So it was ended April 1st, to be honest, right with the introduction of all SpringWave new products. That offer has been extended to the 30th of this month. So you could still sell that offer. Effectively, when you sell the Dynamics 365 offer for SMB, you get Dynamics 365 for Sales, the enterprise feature set, for $40. So if you have new customers coming up, take my advice, sell them only one license, you get them for $40, and you're able, for that instance, for that customer, to sell at that price point up to 25 customers within the first 3 years after the first activation of the first license. So if you want to help your customer out a little bit more, you have to tell them that after 3 years, this offer ends. Above the 25 users, you have to pay in full for the rest of the users. But up to 25 users, you effectively have Dynamics 365 for Sales per enterprise at less than half the price. So, well, it's only 2 weeks. So I probably will not repeat this slide in the next session, but yeah, if you have a scenario where you're at the brink of getting the deal, probably this is a deal breaker, deal winner, you probably are able to get that customer aboard with a much better price point anyway. So I see a few resellers who are doing this actively, but you have to know this is around. So only those resellers are able to leverage on this benefit anyway. So that's one thing. There's also another offer, which is called Dynamics 365 for Sales and Customer Service. Effectively, the only upward migration would be to go to Customer Engagement Plan, but effectively you get Sales and Customer Service, both applications, for $65. That's a real good deal, a maximum of 50 users. So that's also a real good deal. So if you have a scenario where that comes up, just sell it, because you are able to add extra licenses up until the 50 top bar within the first 3 years after the first sale. So still a good scenario, but after June 30th, this is deal is off the table anyway. Let's see how Microsoft gets into the new fiscal year with maybe a new offer. I'm not promising anything. I expect Microsoft to not do anything. So maybe you can leverage a little bit on this. And otherwise, yeah, just go for the higher price point. To be really clear on this, I would still say, but that's my opinion, it shouldn't be about price. It should be about what the customer gains from having you implement this. But yeah, that's just looking a little bit differently at the same. So let's go into that really shiny new product called Microsoft Dynamics 365 for Marketing. So licensing is a little bit different here. So this adds complexity. So getting a university degree on licensing really makes sense, but let's get a little bit more on this. When you go into Dynamics 365 for Marketing, this is a summary of all capabilities you get. And effectively, this is a real gem of a solution in the Dynamics 365 family, because this is really delivering a big bunch of functionality. And I see a lot of customers thinking about ending their Click Dimensions license at some point in time and moving into this functionality. It's a bit challenging, but that's more on data perspective, but this is real beauty. What will be in here? First of all, you can do multi-channel campaigns in this. Well, that's a little bit more than MailChimp, to be honest. You can do MailChimp email marketing, but you also are adding landing pages and forms to the mix. You can have webinars and phone calls and in-person events organized with multi-channel campaigns. There's a LinkedIn lead connector for this also available in Dynamics 365 for Marketing, which is a real beauty. So I see a lot more LinkedIn connection functionality coming up the next few years. So just wait and see what all is coming up anyway. So you have lead nurturing capability, and this is really a shining gem, because this combined with this embedded intelligence, you can do you can design campaigns, you can have multiple lead scoring, embedded intelligence decision making graphs in here. You can automatically segment your customers based on specific actions your customer take. But for example, when they read your email, within 2 days, they get segmented into a different group of targets than when they open it, with, let's say, within 2 weeks, or when they get to your landing page and they fill out all the details, they get more attention, they get prioritized a little bit higher. So you can combine all those things a little bit more, a lot more than when you're having separate solutions for all this kinds of marketing functionality in-house. You can have all kinds of alerting in here, and you have a big bunch of insights also connected to Power BI in this. So reporting will be a breeze. You have a lot more functionality available. I will be doing a QBS talk after the summer, specifically on Dynamics 365 for Marketing. I will demo a lot of stuff. So keep an eye out on the date for that. We will send out an invitation anyway, but I will do a lot more on marketing anyway. I will tell you a lot more about it. But also included in that is a real beauty of an event management solution. Even when you combine it with an ON24 account, you can even host your online webinars. So you could have virtual events, you could have in-person events, you could have attendee tracking available, speaker management, all the things you probably experience when you go to Inspire or Directions or Extreme 365. All those things are at your disposal as well. So if you want to organize an event yourself, this is really, really nice functionality. And then dashboarding, surveys, embedded Power BI, everything's in here. So it's a real beauty of a solution. But it's not cheap. To go for the marketing packaging, you have to go for either a minimum of 10 users on a plan, or you have to go for a separate board base package. And that's costing $1,500 per month. It's a monthly price, but then you get the entire solutions and you're able to have 10,000 contacts actively involved in your campaigns. And if you want to add more contacts into your campaigns, you just have to purchase extra 5K contacts packs. So they are priced at a $250 mark. There's actually also an offer on this as well. It's only valid until the 30th of September. So that's way ahead into the new first quarter of Microsoft fiscal year 2018. You get a 50% discount on all additional 5K contacts SKUs. So, well, all pretty nice. So it's nice that they do something like this, but I would say a discount on that first 10K context would have made a little bit more sense to get a lot more customers on it. But okay, that's Microsoft, right? So if you go to the plan attached version, so if you sell 10 plan seats, you get the 2K context anyway, and to get to the first 10K contacts, you have to purchase a separate $600 package called the first 1K. And after that, you can purchase another an additional 5K contacts for that $250, or until the 30th of September for $250. So that's a 50% discount will be stay valid for the first 3 years after purchase. So that's a nice benefit. So if you have a few customers on board, which larger customer bases or larger marketing contact bases, this really makes sense to have a better price point in there. So what you also have is the marketing application attached. So if you already have applications sold, so you're not selling, you're not reselling only the marketing application, but you also have a few Dynamics 365 customer engagement for sales or service, both are apply. If you have one of those two, you just sell the Dynamics 365 marketing application attached. That's priced at the $750 mark. And effectively, that gives you 10K contacts right out of the box. Effectively, actually, this is a real nice price. If you compare this, you are obviously going to do this anyway, probably. If you compare this to ClickDimensions, that is a little bit lower at price point. That's about around, I thought around $500, $450, something like that. It's a similar amount of contacts, a little bit higher. I thought of 15K, but you have to have a look at that. They are changing this a little bit around to the last 2 months. So that's why I'm not entirely certain. So they can compare because Dynamics 365 Marketing offers you more functionality and is better integrated anyway. So that kind of makes good for a little bit more higher price point. But there's also a downside. This is a new product and ClickDimensions is an established product. So, well, there's a choice to be made here. Well, the last one will be a transition attached for Microsoft Dynamics Marketing. If you already have sold Microsoft Dynamics Marketing, your customers can transition into this marketing module anyway. You probably would have sold this 2 years ago or 3 years ago. So, okay, that would make sense. But for most of us, we didn't sell Microsoft Dynamics Marketing anyway because it wasn't really a good product, to be honest. So for the customers who have, resellers who have a customer with Microsoft Dynamics Marketing, there is a transition offer. And it's a real good price point anyway. So there you go. So there's also a few limits in here. What's included in here? There is a inclusion in the application standalone version of Microsoft Social Engagement, a voice of the customer, which effectively is a questionnaire product. You have a portal included. You also get a sandbox instance with it and storage. All those things really don't make sense for a plan or an application attached because you already have that. You already have because you're combining this with an enterprise user, you already have a non-production instance, you already have a sufficient storage, or you already have that portal. So if you do the plan attached versions, you don't get all these inclusions, but you don't need them. So that's really making sense out of this slide anyway. So if you go to the standalone packaging, you only have two choices. You start with a marketing standalone application, and then with the 10K contacts, and you get additional 5K contacts as additions to that if you need them. So if you go for the attached version, so there is two, right? You have the marketing 2K contacts combined with customer engagement plan when you have 10 licenses sold, and then you just have all the other applications at your disposal anyway: sales, customer service, field service and project service automation, relationship sales only accounts if you have enterprise agreements, so wouldn't make any sense in most markets. The other one will be marketing attached to plan. So if you want to attach to this plan, you would have to add the first 8K contacts, and then you can buy additional 5K contacts. So first the $600 version and then the $250 version. Am I still making sense? Okay, it's a little bit complex. Just ask your representative of QBS anyway if you have any questions about it, or reach out to me and I'll help you with this. Marketing application per organization. If you attach to applications, you get the 10K contacts out of the box anyway for $750. And then you add additional contacts for 5K at that. So, okay, is it complex? Well, maybe a little bit. So, I kind of rushing through this. Let's go into packaging and pricing. So, though we just did complete all the marketing products and sales products, let's now look at how pricing and how the price point look. So first of all, if you go to the customer engagement plan, so that's the highlighted part, so the colored part in here, that's priced at a $115 price per user per month. That $150 can go as low as $60 per user per month, but that's a volume discount. So if you go in a bit larger volume, you get it lowered, but it's in the 100. So above 100 users, this really makes sense. Under the 100 users, you stay at the $115. So if you stay at the $115, that's, if you look at it, a pretty good price point, but for that $115, you get sales, customer service, power apps, field service, and project service automation, and 2K contacts on marketing if you sell 10 seats. So that's a pretty solid price, to be honest. If you go for only $20, right? And if you go for one application, you would start at sales in most cases or customer service, and that would make it a $95 per user per month price. So what's Power Apps in this? Well, Power Apps effectively enables you to build your own applications. You could also buy Power Apps licenses. You can build your own applications. So if you don't need a sales or customer service application, but you have your own process to build, you can build that on Power Apps. This is the Power Apps app license. And with the Power Apps app license, you get database storage. Pretty neat functionality, effectively using the database model of CRM anyway. And that's a little bit different as the Power Apps license, which is included in Office 365 Enterprise SKUs. So nice product, and that's included in the customer engagement plan anyway. So that's pretty nice. So there's the team member license pricing. If you go for team members, those are priced at $8 per user per month price point. So you still have to do the math if you go to UK pounds or European euros. So if you go to the add-ons, there's also a few things you probably have to sell extra at most implementations. And actually the most reselled, the most sold addition to customer engagement plan is effectively the additional database storage. But in, because in most cases, your database grows, right? You are adding more and more data. And in the case you're adding email attachments, so you're tracking emails in CRM, and you're also tracking attachments. So there you go, then your database will explode. So adding extra database storage really makes sense. As you can see, 1 gig of database storage costs $5 per month. That effectively is a really expensive database. So Azure is cheaper, and well, SharePoint or OneDrive, well, that's far cheaper. So what would you say? Most experienced CRM partners effectively do the following scenario. They advise their customers to implement a solution. There's a few ISV ones, and there is a few on AppSource. There's also a solution for Microsoft itself, which effectively is offloading all email attachments from CRM database and uploading that in, for example, Azure Storage or in SharePoint, for example. So your attachments would all sit in there, would still be connected to your CRM data, but not having, not costing extra database space. So your CRM database would still stay fairly clean. And with that first 10 gigabytes of storage, you get, well, that's pretty solid. A normal organization with, let's say, 25 users, will grow a database storage of around 5 to 10 gigabytes per year. So keep an eye on that at your customer site, at your customer implementation, because you have to sell that 1 gigabyte additional database storage before that database limit is reached, because otherwise you have a dissatisfied customer and you're easing the pain, but still the customer is dissatisfied first. So what would be the other infrastructure add-ons? You could sell an extra production instance or two. That depends on how your implementation works. If you have a fairly complex implementation, this actually really makes sense to have more production instances for different amounts, sets of data. The other one will be additional non-production instances, extra sandboxes. That really makes sense because in most implementations where you have a little bit more complexity than standard sales, having a few more sandboxes really makes sense. So you can test out multiple scenarios or multiple stages if you want to have a staging area implemented. So you can implement in multiple stages to go to an acceptance testing, and then it go into live after that, and that would really, really make sense. So you have the dev testing, the acceptance testing, and then going into live. So adding additional portal licenses also makes sense if you would have want to have multiple portals, let's say an employee portal and a customer portal, or let's say a supplier portal and a customer portal or something like that. So with the additional portal license, you get an extra instance, so you get an extra URL. You can build on the same database, and that really works. So I've seen customers doing this. All prices are in a per month perspective, so just so you know. Then you have consumption add-ons. So additional portal page views, what does that mean? So an additional portal or a normal portal include 500K page views, so 500,000 views of a portal page. So yeah, reaching that limit, okay, then you would really have a commercial site, but still you can purchase additional 500,000 page views for $50 extra. And you could also go into a social engagement, which is also included with the enterprise license. And in social engagement, you could buy additional posts. So you're entitled to post 10K social engagement posts. And you could, if you would have a very, very active social marketing department, effectively, you could buy additional social engagement posts, even up until 1 million. I have never seen that scenario, to be honest, but yeah, it can happen, right? It depends on what you do. So, and then you have the additional marketing 5K contacts, right? So first, for the plan attach, you would have the 2K contacts. You have to purchase the additional special SKU, which is called additional 8K contacts to get to the 10. Then you buy the additional 5K for $250 per month. So there you go. So mixing and matching all those licenses. Yeah, it's about being smart, to be honest. And in this specific scenario, I would say you always have the choice to combine plans with application licenses, with the exception of the scenario I stipulated on Dynamics 365 for sales between enterprise and professional license. I would say those mixing and matching scenarios are not really appealing, so you really have to, it's more about a choice than mixing and matching. But mixing and matching on if you sell enterprise and plan combinations, you also would have the opportunity for the team members. Activity is not relevant for this specific side of the Dynamics 365 products. So activity would be more a operation thing, but team members, plans and applications, and smart combinations of those really make sense. So what is the meaning of all those team member licensing, right? So I will show you an example on the differences on those, but suffice to say that team members are meant to get a kind of data democracy policy throughout your organization of your customer. Because what happens is you get all those licenses for all those applications, sales, let's say customer service, maybe project service automation, but not everybody has a license to get into their data. And that really would make sense to have a real low price point user to be able to review the data and maybe even to add a little bit of communication to that. So that's where this all comes in. So you have basic functionality, basic limitations, but you can still view data, work with the same data, but you're not able to participate in active processes like sales or customer service, but you're still able to view the data. And that really will make sense. So for the average management team at the average customer, just assign them team member licensing anyway. So what's the difference between all those? So we talked about this a little bit more, but a little bit in last slides. So the difference will be full users. Just think about the feasibility to sell a plan if they are using more than one of those applications. Plan is always the best way to go, even if you don't use all the products in here. If you only go for one application like customer service or sales or field service or any of those, just go for the application. Just saves $20. So go for that scenario. And the additional users always go for the team members because that really makes sense. So what's an example of combinations? So an example of what would be the difference in functionality on those licensing options. I'm providing here a slide. What you see here is you see a license comparison in Dynamics 365 for sales for sales professional versus enterprise versus team members. So whilst I still advise you not to combine sales professional enterprise, you can see as a example, what's the difference in what you're entitled to do. So you're not entitled to Power Apps license when you have a team member. You're not entitled to do opportunity management. You're able to watch and to view opportunity data, but you're not able to participate in the process. You're still able to see all custom entities and to work with all custom entities. You're still able to add a extra email to CRM, to track an email in CRM, or to add an extra task or something like that. And that combination with, for example, a sales enterprise or with a professional implementation, that really makes sense. So this will be a good example. There's a licensing guide, which we also will provide. And in that licensing guide, you will see those examples also for customer service, project service automation, and field service automation. Another very interesting thing you have to understand is the external user policy Microsoft has. So in general, looking at this graph, but in general, what effectively means is you are able to open your data to external users with a portal, for example, or giving them a sign in. If they are not actively participating in your processes, they're not seen as internal users. If they are effectively, they are outsourced partners, but they effectively participate in your core processes, then they are seen as internal users and you have to purchase user subscription licenses. If they just are able, like let's say customers or suppliers, they only provide data, so they are not part of your process, then you can provide them. You don't have to purchase extra licenses for them. So for example, if you want to have a customer portal, a customer can submit support cases and review existing support cases. That doesn't require a need for extra licenses for those customer users. So that effectively mitigates that need. But if you have a subcontractor working with you on the same cases and they only have access through the portal, they are still seen as internal users and you need to buy an extra license for them. So just so you know, that's the difference between internal and external users. A few extra resources. So we will provide you with the slide deck anyway, but There's a few interesting resources here. Those are links you can have a look at. Very interesting to see what are the data sheets for the specific products. You have a licensing overview deck. There's also a transition guidance deck. That's even a bigger slide deck. And that transition guidance effectively helps when you have a customer, which you are trying to get on board, and that customer is only using licenses from older versions of CRM, for example. You have to help them transition to the newer licensing, or they have on-premise licensing or something like that. That transition guidance deck really makes sense, because then at a lower, substantial lower price point or on a discount offer, you can get them onto the new online licensing anyway. So that really would make sense. So that kind of ends my slide deck. I think I have brought a lot of information here. So it's a bit, little bit big to get your bearings around. I would say there's a lot more to tell around it, but I wanted to give a small, let's kind of a summary of the entire thing. So I will be open to questions. If there's anything you want to ask me specifically, just type it in the chat box or speak out. I'm happy to help you out. Otherwise, I would say I would thank you for participating in this webinar.